Hello and welcome to Curator with a Camera. I'm Anthony Coulls, Senior Curator of Rail Transport and Technology at the National Railway Museum. And today, we're going to have a look at this beast behind us, the locomotive that others call Sir, the Deltic locomotive, King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry. So we're here in the north shed of the National Railway Museum. Very appropriate because this was the site of York Diesel Depot until the 1980s. And locomotives such as this, Deltic No. 2, D9002, King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry, known as KOYLI to its friends, is very appropriately on display here. This is the locomotive that it has been said others call Sir. The Deltic is the locomotive that transforms mainline passenger travel on the East Coast Main Line so that it's now able to run at 100 miles an hour. It cuts the journey time by minutes, even hours on occasions on certain schedules, and it really changes the way that things operate. So how does the Deltic come about? By 1955, British Railways produced and published their modernisation plan that said this is the future, this is the way that railways are going to go. We're going to go diesel. And the diesels that they commissioned were heavy. They had very slow revving diesel engine power units. These were in essence mobile power stations, but they wasted a lot of energy by lugging themselves around. So 1955, the Deltic prototype was created. It used two Napier Deltic power units, and they were lighter, they were faster revving, so the thing was able to put a lot more power down on the rails. And these production Deltics, with the two power units inside, were, for a time, the most powerful single unit prime mover in the UK. They were able to produce 3,300 horsepower. How can it do that? It's down to the Deltic power unit. Why is it called the Deltic Power Unit? Well, we refer to my Ladybird Book of Trains, how it works, the locomotive. And although I'm not a Greek scholar, the shape of the way the pistons are arranged and the cylinders in the power unit resembles the Greek letter delta. So that's it. In that triangle arrangement, it is the Deltic Power Unit. Amazingly, 22 of these Deltics replaced 55 of the A4 and A3 Pacific locos, like Flying Scotsman and Mallard, on such services as the Flying Scotsman. And Deltic 2, KOYLI here, is presented with the thistle headboard there, the emblem of the Flying Scotsman service. In steam days, there were headboards, as there are up the wall there, which we can see just behind us, that said Flying Scotsman, the Night Scotsman, and Flying Scotsman up to the top. But when the service was dieselized, these winged thistles were created specifically for the diesel service. The 1950s diesel locos that British Railways had commissioned were this plain green here. The Deltics had their own identity, and this lime green was added. So it's two-tone green. This is what's known as two-tone green. But initially, they didn't have the yellow panel on the front. They were just that clean, dark green all the way around with the head code panel in the middle. Why is there this yellow panel on the front of the Deltic? So the yellow front is there to protect track workers and crews and people in depots so that when they hear the horn, they look up, the sound of the horn, the audible warning, and they see this. But in latter years, through the 90s into the 2000s, this locomotive had a period of operation on the main line, and main line railways, train operating companies, require that you had a high intensity headlamp on this. So not only did you see the yellow front, but you had this headlamp here. You can't miss it. While we're looking at the front end of the loco here, let's have a look at the head code box, the train reporting number. And before you write in and put in the comments on YouTube that it's wrong, we know. But all trains have what's called a reporting number, and it defines what it is, where it is, where it's going, and a classification number. So the first digit, the one, that goes 1 to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. That number denotes the class of train that the locomotive is pulling from. One is express passenger train through 2, 3, 4, whether it's a stopping train, whether it's a goods train, whether it's a light engine service, anything like that. The second digit, the letter, that denotes where and what route the train is taking. And then the last two numbers, 3, 5, are like a code which identifies it on a list of trains. So 1 or 00 to 99 will just be an identifier with the train crew and control. So these train reporting numbers are still used today, but have their roots decades before now. Moving from the front of the loco to the back then, we've got things that became Deltic features. For a period in the late 70s and early 80s of the Deltics, we began to be on their way out. The Finsbury Park Depot in North London began to put these white window surrounds on their locos. It gave the Deltic a signature look. There's the works plate, English Electric Company. Of course, they provided all the electric gear and they had the contract. It's an English Electric Deltic. But they were actually built physically at the Vulcan foundry at Newton Le Willows in the northwest of England. There's the number, D9002, reminding us that it's one of a class of 22 locos from D9000 to D9021. There's the British Railways crest there, the famous lion with a wheel, lion and wheel. Quite why it's got a blue tongue, I don't know. Please let us know in the comments if you have any insight into that. And of course the engine is mounted on two six-wheel bogies. Its wheel arrangement is called Coco. And you can see the springs, the suspension, and the cast bogie frame. If you're into this sort of thing, these bogies are very similar to those that were used on Class 37 and Class 50 locos. And there is the Smith's speedometer. We see this on a number of our mainline operating locos. And that speedo gives a reading up in the cab of what the loco is able to do. And then we move further along with two very large fuel tanks underneath, painted in dark green. That's actually quite a good thing of having this lamp on today. If you're modelling, quite often you look at models of one of these engines and people paint the underframes black, but you can see here it is actually the same dark green as the body side there. But above us is the nameplate. There we are, King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry. So King's Own Yorkshire Light Infantry is a mouthful, and certainly in latter years, enthusiasts have referred to it as KOYLI for short. And the engines that were based in the north that were shedded out of Haymarket in Edinburgh and Gateshead in Newcastle, they were all given names of regiments, whether they were Yorkshire or Northeastern or Scottish. And then the engines that worked out of Finsbury Park in London were all named after racehorses, horses that had won the St. Ledger or Ascot or the Derby. And in fact, some of those names were repeated from steam locos that they replaced all those years on. Okay, so having had a look at the outside of this magnificent powerhouse, let's go and see what's inside the cab. Here we are in number two end of KOYLI. The Deltics come in 1961. That's only a year after the last steam locomotive is made for British Railways. It's a complete and utter step change though. It's quite industrial still, but you do have a padded seat and I can move it slightly. I can move it up and down as well. But in terms of that very physical, brutal life of a locomotive driver or a fireman, this is essentially sedentary. But it doesn't mean you're lazy. You've got to be vigilant on the job at all time, because behind you is this enormous powerhouse of an engine. So what does it all do? What are all these gadgets and gizmos? Let's have a look at what we've got in front of us and how you make this engine go. Now, it's probably 10 years since I drove this last, but I think I can remember what all the bits do. So you can't make the loco go without engaging a master key just in here. That's not there, so we aren't going anywhere today. Of course, you've started the engine as well by now. You've got the power unit running, it's built up air pressure. So you put a master key in there, you engage the direction you want it to go, so you can see it's off there, forward, reverse, and engine only. So engine only is like neutral, so it's not going to go anywhere, but the engine still continues to run. Off, of course, shuts it down. You've got a train air brake here and a locomotive air brake here. So this air brake only operates on the loco itself. This one goes through to the brakes on the train. And these locomotives were fitted with air brakes during the 1960s. So once you've got the brake, you've got direction, and then here, this is the power handle, and you can say it's off, minimum, right through to maximum. Now that won't go unless I've engaged direction, I've got brakes, and I've got the power handle in. So you can see it won't go anywhere at the present time. We also have the overriding ultimate safety, which is down at my feet, of the DSD, or dead man's pedal. That is connected to the signalling, the automatic warning system, and the sunflower there. If the signal is green, there will be a bell that will ring, and I have to acknowledge that and keep my foot down on the dead man's pedal there. If I don't acknowledge that, the brakes will come on. If my foot comes off the dead man's pedal, the brakes will also come on there, so it's a fail-safe. What else have we got in front of us here? Well, we've got all these dials, speedometer, all in miles an hour. We've got the ammeter there for the amps going through to the traction motor, and the traction motors, that's the power going down onto the track. The main reservoir for the air, which is for the controls. Then you've got the brake pipe air there, and you've got the vacuum gauge here for the vacuum brakes, and then the brake cylinders for the locomotive itself on bogie 1 and bogie 2, one at each end of the engine. We have a number of other push switches: engine start, engine stop, earth fault, then things like cab heaters. Because like we said earlier, this is such a change from the steam loco world that you don't have a fire in front of us. There's nothing to keep you warm or dry or whatever. And actually, it's very drafty at 100 miles an hour. There's a lot of places in a loco where air can get through, wind can get through. Of course, you want a bit of ventilation, but you also want to be a little bit warmer. So you've got those. But also some more up-to-date features because of this engine having run latterly on the main line and being equipped to do so. So we have the GSMR radio system, and then the most recent, the OTMR on-track monitoring system there, which also has a link to the GSMR, and there's a cab phone which will contact, you can use to contact control and signals. The GSMR and the OTMR look a little bit like a radio system there, don't they? But I don't think you can get classic FM on that. Now, looking out through cab windows across the nose, we can see there's some access hatches in the top of that nose. Now, what are those for? Let's have a look in number two end, caution, low headroom. I probably won't actually go in here because I may not fit. But what have we got in here? We have a number of auxiliary fittings. So there are compressors there for charging of the air brakes and other systems, control systems. We have the blower for the traction motor to keep them cool, because like the locomotive, well, it's like the power unit themselves, the traction motors also get very hot. And there you can see not a unique feature, but an unusual feature. It has its own urinal. And bear in mind that this thing was running from London to Edinburgh a lot of the time, and the driver or second man couldn't necessarily pop back into the train for a comfort break. So the Deltic had it provided with its own water tank and cistern above it, just in case the call of nature screamed at you somewhere around Potter's Bar. We look now in the 21st century of something like the 125 high-speed train, which enjoys a working life of some 45 years or more. The Deltics, for all their mainline high-speed epic operations, really only had 20 years in the limelight. And the final day that the Deltic operated on British Rail's main line was January 1982, 6th of January 1982, terminating at King's Cross amidst amazing scenes of people pretty much worshipping these locos. One guy even being caught on the national news planting a kiss on the side of the engine. Absolutely amazing hero worship of a piece of engineering power. Thanks for joining us today for Curator with a Camera. Why not like and subscribe? And while stocks last, you have the chance to buy a superb model of this incredible locomotive behind us. See the description for details.